different views and different school of thoughts when it comes to the subject of the Holy Spirit. But I want to tell you what I believe. Amen. I believe that we have one God that exists concurrently in three distinct personalities. Amen. The personality of the Father, the personality of the Son, and then the personality of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I have much things to say, so that is why I want to just get straight into it. And I want to address three things. I wanted to, that God will take me long, to also speak to you what does the Bible mean about the unpardonable sin that you commit against the Holy Spirit, and then what grieves the Holy Spirit. Amen. But I want to believe that other ministers will do that as you continue with this series. I want to address you on three things. The first one being the Lordship of the Holy Spirit. The second one being the deity of the Holy Spirit. And then finally, we would also speak about the personality of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Also, I will just allow you to flow in my heart. It will depend on which one God wants me to start with first. Amen. But can we bow our heads? Hallelujah. And Lord, we kiss your feet repeatedly in honor of your name. We thank you for corn from the ground and wine from the vine. We pray for open eyes like the two guys on the road to Emmaus. We pray for open scriptures and we pray for open understanding. And Father, we refuse at this moment to depend on what we know. And we pray for the guidance, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, our helper, to continue to show us truth in Scripture. We pray for accurate representation of doctrinal matters because doctrine informs our lives. And we pray that you open our hearts to know the deep things and the wonderful things in your world. And the our prayer is that in all our getting, we may get understanding. As we pray in Jesus' name, and everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I want you to open with me Isaiah chapter number 6. We need to identify the Holy Spirit from Isaiah. And please say this with me. Say the Father.
The Father.
Say the Son.
The Son.
And say the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
When you read 2 Corinthians chapter number 13, verse 14, you can write that. It says, the grace of our Lord Jesus, and it says the love of God, and it says the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. I think there's need for me to clarify that there's harmony in the Trinity. It's important for me that I clarify that, because we serve a God who always expresses truth in three dimensions. When he speaks to Paul, he says three things: faith, hope, and love. When he speaks to Noah, he says three things: build me a tabernacle. It must have a foundation. It must have a door. And there must be a window. Symbolically, the door is the Father, the foundations to everything. The door to the sheepfold, the Son. The window where the dove came out, the Holy Spirit. When God spoke to Moses, he also said, Moses, take the rod. So Moses took the rod that was in his hands. And he said, Moses, strike the rock. And water came out. The rod symbolically, God the Father, striking the rock, the sun, through crucified life, so that Pentecost can release the Holy Spirit. So it's three things involved all the time, biblical. Amen. You read about the stages as the anointing cascades after ordination. It touches three places in the head of the high priest. It touches the head, it touches the beard, and it touches the skirt. The head stands headship, the beard maturity, the skirt the church, the bride. Men don't wear dresses, remember. So the church, being the bride, the woman of the issue of blood, touched the place where the anointing is the strongest. And then she was actually healed. You read throughout Genesis until Exodus, God introduces himself. He says, I'm one God. And then when he introduces covenant, one covenant, but it touches three persons. So it's also one God that touches three persons. Genesis 1, 2, Edenic covenant, Genesis 3, Adamic covenant, Genesis 6, Noahic covenant. He also introduced the rainbow. Amen. We see that also in the book of Revelation. And I want to ensure that we allow scripture to interpret scripture. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so that we don't say what the Bible is not saying. So when God introduced himself, the same covenant to Abraham, and he took the same covenant, introduced it to Isaac. He has not changed. I'm God and I changed not. And then he introduced the same covenant to Jacob. And then he raises Moses and says, the children of Israel are crying. When they ask you who sends you, he says, tell them that I am what I am sends you. And then when he comes before the elders, he says, the God of Abraham, the God of Jacob, of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Now, how do we dovetail? How do we link the two, the old covenant and the new covenant? And we do apostolic work because the apostles never had the New Testament. So they took from the Old Testament to give us the New Testament. And if you're surely an apostle in our day and hour, you should be able to do that. For me, an apostle must be mighty in the scriptures. For me, an apostle must be able to announce that this scripture is fulfilled in your ears. Jesus took the book of Isaiah and says, after reading the synagogue, and said, this scripture is fulfilled. Peter, on the door of Pentecost, read a verse that was 700 years old, and he said, what you see happening today, 9 o'clock in the morning, these people are not drunk as he supposed. But this is that which God spoke through the mouth of Joel, that I will pour out my spirit upon sons and daughters. So now, grace is no longer gender specific. There are no longer distinctions in this thing. God is anointing the whole house. So if you come to me and say, touch not my anointed, I say, I'm anointed to you. Because your father is now my father. Jesus is our elder brother. He has cut a long list of distinctions, and unfortunately, from a church context, we are still caught up in those things. Let me leave you on such things. But the introduction is, I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of Isaac. I'm the God of Jacob. So when we see that in the New Testament, John, the apostle, will then write, he says there are three that bear record in heaven. He says, it is the Father, it is the Word, and it is the Spirit. And then he also says, there are three that bear witness in the heavens. He says the blood, he says the water, and he says the Spirit. Now how do you link? Because what is in the old is the type of what is in the new. So from the antitype, from the type to the antitype, you need to connect and make sure that when you interpret scripture, there is no contradiction. And if it so happens that you use the principle of type and symbolism for the purpose of interpreting scripture, you should at least understand that that its purpose is not to establish doctrine but to explain it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm using it to explain, not to establish. Otherwise, you'll be using a whole lot of allegoric meanings and so on, and you make scripture to say what scripture is not saying. And then you start releasing baseless revelations that cannot be substantiated with scripture. Because you can easily make the Bible to say what the Bible is not saying. So now let's look at this. I'm the God of Abraham, and I studied the life of Abraham, and I discovered that he's the man of the altar, who slaughtered an animal and make a sacrifice before the Lord. That's how they expressed worship in those times. They were not singing, they were building altars, and they were putting sacrifices and sweet smelling aroma unto the Lord. So singing is not necessarily worship, it's an aspect of worship. Music is connected to worship, but music is not worship. You can meet the best skilled, anointed person, but that does not make them worship. What makes us worshipers is our right standing with God, a relationship with God. It is of the heart, and remember, it's not a song, it's a lifestyle.
Yeah.
Are we together?
Yeah.
So I'm the God of Abraham, Abraham. And the Bible says he's the man of the altar. He will erect an altar. At 75 years, he obeyed the call. At 70 years, God started to speak actually through his father Terah. But he was building altars. Can we say altars? And then he dies, so let's remove him. I see an altar in his life. And then he dies. And his son comes into the picture. And God has an encounter with the son. And the son goes back to the wells of Jacob, and he redigs the well, and water comes out. So I see that in the life of the son, there's a principle of the well. So in Abraham, I see the principle of the altar. In Isaac, I see the principle of the well. And then what about Jacob? He's running away from his brother. Also ran away from, he ran away from God for 20 years. 20 years.
Hmm.
What do I see in his life? He's a tent man. He met Rachel at the well. You see, if you meet a woman at the well, it is well, my brother. Because out of the well, you have water. It's just symbolic. Because the things that are written aforetime are written for our learning, so that through faith and comfort of the scriptures, we might have hope. And then when an apostle like John looks at the life of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he's not going to give us a principle that addresses us as the New Testament church established on better promises, better covenant, better promises. He says there are three that bear record in heaven. And then he says, the blood bears witness. It doesn't make sense until you make the connection. The connection is from Abraham's altar, when we slaughter an animal, blood. And then he says water. Still doesn't, people are thinking water baptism. And then he says blood, and then he says water. So in Isaac's life, the principle that we see from his life, wells, water. And then in Jacob's life, he begins to address the tent principle. But before the tent, this is what I want you to see. He's the first man in the Bible to use the holy anointing oil. And when he took the oil, he anointed the rock. What are we doing with oil today? Many things. When oil was used for the first time, it was used to recognize the anointed one, the rock. So we should use oil not only to heal the sick, to anoint, to recognize the healer. Because the sick may be healed, but the healer does not receive the credit he deserves, because somebody major has taken credit. May God help us. So there are three that bear record in heaven. The water he was thinking about, Abraham's altar. He was thinking about, the water was thinking about Isaac's well. And the blood he was thinking about, Abraham's altar. And then Jacob, tent, wind will blow upon his tent. That's the principle. So we are thinking that bear record. So in actual fact, he was talking about Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, connecting the covenant of the same God, that we have one God who exists concurrently in three distinct personalities. Mm-hmm. Now, if I have to use that as an example for you to understand the Godhead, I will say, the Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not the Son, nor the Father. The Father is not the Son, nor the Holy Spirit. The Son is not the Father, and the Son is not the Holy Spirit. The Father is the only Father. The Son is the only Son. And the Spirit is the only Spirit. Yet they are the same God. You see, when you try to use your mind to understand the mystery of the Godhead, it will mess you up. Mm-hmm. Because in the Trinity Godhead, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, the word Godhead is in the Bible. So we are picking up from an understanding that there are three persons in this one God. So please understand that in the Father we see the unity of the Trinity. In the Son we see the equality of the Trinity. In the Holy Spirit we see the harmony of the Trinity. In other words, they are united in the Father. They are equal in the Son. And they are harmonious in the Holy Spirit. That is why the Son could say, Paul would even say, God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. Mm-hmm. And then the Bible will also say, in the Son, the fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him bodily. Mm-hmm. Then you might ask your question, because there are key things from Scripture. One of them is, whose Son is this? John 3:16. God so loved the world so much he gave his only begotten Son. Who is the Father then? God is the Father. The Son comes through Isaiah. It says afterwards the child is born and the Son is given and the government shall be upon his shoulder and he shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father. To the point even Philip is confused that Jesus says to him, wherever I go, I will take you. And Philip goes like, okay, show us the Father so that it satisfies us. And Jesus looks at Philip and says, have I been with you for such a long time and still do not know me, Philip? And the Hebrew writer will still come and say the Son is the express image of the invisible, the exact representation. That if you have seen the Son, you have seen the Father. And then the Bible will say that the birth of the Messiah and the life story of Joseph and Mary, that the Holy Spirit came upon Mary, and that holy thing shall be called the child of the Holy Ghost. How many fathers do we have so far? The Son says, I'm the Father. The Father says, I'm the Son. The Holy Ghost says, is my child. This child is it is God trying to say, don't use your mind on this thing. So we declare, we say, we know that there's a Father, we know that there's a Son, and we know that there's a Holy Spirit. But they exist concurrently in three distinct personalities. And what happens at the baptism? At the baptism, the Father's voice speaks, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Where's the Son? River Jordan, the age of 30, the number of maturity. Where's the Holy Spirit? Like the dove that escaped Noah's Ark. I believe that. The dove that escaped Noah's Ark appears right there at the baptism. And who do we see? We see three functions of the same God. Praise the Lord. So he's one God that exists in three distinct personalities. And he has always used that principle of three most of the time to express his nature and to express his person. Now, there are also three things I want you to understand concerning the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's prove from Scripture his deity, Isaiah. So I'm just going to give you Scripture in comparison to other Scripture. So we are just going to dovetail, link two verses, Isaiah 60. Amen. Please say the Lordship of the Spirit. I'll be done just now. Amen. This is a foundational subject. We should know it by head by now. And maybe I'm going to also help you. How do you see, maybe in 5 minutes after this, how do you hear him in 1 minute, just in 1 minute, 30 seconds? Because for me, it takes takes 1 minute, 30 seconds for you to flow in the house of God and to capture your prophetic flow. When I look prophetic, fine. Praise the Lord. That's why you have dreams. Amen. You ask for them now. Dreams and visions are languages in the spirit. Not every dream though comes. The problem is that prophetic schools don't teach you to hear. You're already hearing my voice, isn't it? Nobody taught you that. Nobody can teach you to hear God. But we have to help you to recognize what you are hearing, because the confusion comes when you hear. You need to determine, to discern, is this God, is this me, or is this the devil? You always battle with the source, you are not battling with the voice. You always hear voices. Some of you hear things,
yeah,
not from the Lord. Amen. The whole house is prophetic, by the way. Now, most people say the Holy Spirit is not Lord. He's just a person, but some say he's an it. Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6. It's important that you understand His Lordship. He is Lord, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. I have a song that says, Spirit, you are Lord in this place. Spirit, you are Lord in our midst. Spirit, you are Lord in this church. You give us liberty. Liberty. Umoyume. We impose. Just as you view Jesus as Lord, the Holy Spirit is. Can we prove it? Chapter 6, verse 10. Verse 8 to 10. Quickly. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord. Can you all say voice of the Lord?
Voice.
Say voice of the Lord.
Voice of the Lord.
Where is the verse? Is in the Old Testament. And we are told that the voice of the Lord. Nothing is said about the Holy Spirit as yet. It says the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And whom shall go for us? Then I said, here I am, send you. And then verse 9 says, and he said, go and tell these people, hear ye indeed, but understand it not. See ye indeed, but perceive it not. So now Paul the Apostle is going to take the very same verse from the Old Testament, and he's going to use it in the New Testament, and to show that the two are equal, he's going to replace the Lord in verse 8 with the Holy Spirit. Let's see that. Amen. It's just minor details, but very much important. Let's go to the book of Acts 28, verse 25 and 27. You will see the same verse is quoted. The Holy Spirit is Lord. So Paul, as the interpreter of God's word, as an apostle also, he does not see it as an error where the prophets put or place the word the Lord. He now replaces it with the Holy Spirit, but he does not see that as an error because they are equal. Acts chapter 28, verse 25. Let's read the verse. It's just a comparison of three verses, and then we'll be done with His Lordship. 25. Sorry, 28, verse 25. 28, verse 25. Paul is addressing as his generation. Isaiah was addressing his during the encounter. Now Paul is using the same verse, but instead of saying Lord, he's putting the Holy Ghost. Verse 25. And when they had agreed among themselves, they departed. After that, Paul had spoken one word. Well, spake the Holy Ghost by Isaiah the prophet unto the fathers. So Paul is saying, the Holy Spirit spoke. And Isaiah says, I heard the voice of the Lord.
So we're just linking the two verses in the Old and in the New, and we see the Holy Spirit taking the place of the Lordship in Scripture. Amen. So saying unto his people, saying unto this people, say, hearing ye shall hear. Did we read the same verse? Mm-hmm. Amen. But you would not perceive. So the two verses are linked in the Old and in the New. The same example continues. We are going to look at, let me just use one because of time. Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah 31. I don't want you to doubt his Lordship. He is Lord. Because have you ever been in the service? Some of you would think, why are you saying that? Have you ever been in the service and you are worshiping God? My sister in the left goes like, thank you, Jesus. My brother in the middle goes like, thank you, Father. And my brother on the right goes like, thank you, Holy Spirit. Who are we worshiping here? Amen. To others is Holy Spirit. Amen. To others is Holy. Are we worshiping three gods or one God? Still one God. Amen. So don't get mixed up with the functions. And when the Holy Spirit plays a subordinate role because of redemption purposes, it does not make him less God. When he becomes the Spirit of the Father and he becomes the Spirit of the Son, that does not make him less God. He's equal to God in glory, in majesty, in power. There is no point where the Holy Spirit is less than God. Why have you lied to the Holy Spirit? And then he said, why did you lie to God? He said, to the Holy Spirit, and then he said, to God. There's a New Testament verse to prove that the Holy Spirit is God, and that's what the apostles were teaching. Jeremiah 31. He speaks about the new covenant. And guess what it says? It says, verse 31. He says, behold, the days come, says the Lord. And remember, these are prophets of Jehovah. Amen? So I might as well say to you, the Holy Spirit is Jehovah. The days come, says the Lord, I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Amen. The same verse is used in Hebrews chapter 10. Please read it at home later. Amen. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 15 to 17. But says the Holy Spirit also, witness to us. For after he had said before, then again he identifies the word Lord with the Holy Spirit. So the same verse you will find it in Hebrews. Again in Hebrews, you find in the book of Isaiah, the Bible says, God says, these people are refusing God's rest. They are refusing God's rest. And God is addressing them. He addresses them in the book of Psalms. And he says, today, when you hear the voice of the Lord, harden not your hearts. When you take it into the New Testament, the Hebrew writer comes and says, today, when you hear the voice of the Holy Spirit speaks expressively today. So where there is Lord in the Old Testament, there is the Holy Spirit in the New Testament to prove that the Holy Spirit is Jehovah. Another significant verse is found when you read 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. It says, now the Spirit is Lord. And where the Spirit of the Lord, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So there is no liberty everywhere. Be careful. Amen? Amen. Liberty is only where he's acknowledged as Lord. He's omnipresent. He is everywhere. But liberty happens only where he is acknowledged as Lord. That verse is supposed to actually be spoken this way or written this way. Where the Spirit of the Lord is acknowledged as Lord, only there is liberty. Amen. Look at it in Acts, in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Praise the Lord. Now, looking at another issue around the deity of the Holy Spirit. I read 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. The last verse, I think it's verse 14. It says, But who knows the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? No one. That's why Job was asked 40 questions in Job 38 and he could not answer. Who knows the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? No one. And then he says, but we have the mind of Christ. What does that mean? It means me and you as believers, we have the mind of Christ. Amen? And then the question is, does the Holy Spirit possess intellect? Because that's a quality of personality. Does he possess intellect? So that's the first attribute I want us to look at. There's a mind of the Lord. There's a mind of Christ. Is there the mind of the Spirit? Romans chapter number 8, verse 26 to verse 27. It says that he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is, for he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Mm. So the Holy Spirit has a mind. That's why you could forbid Paul. He can decide even on giftings and so on. He has a mind. So he's not some power. He has intellect. He just does not possess a body. Amen? Another attribute that adds to personality. Amen. Does he have a will? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11. 9 gifts of the Spirit. After the 9 gifts are mentioned in verse 11, Paul says, but these gifts are distributed severally as the Holy Spirit wills. He has a will. He can say no. Amen. He is not intimidated by a worship song. You cannot twist his arm through fasting. You cannot do all things that we do to try to appeal to God or to please him. And then we think we're just going to twist the arm of the Almighty God. He has a will. He can just say no after prayer. Amen. So the Holy Spirit has a mind. The Holy Spirit has a will. Does he have emotions? Yes, he has. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. The Bible says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. So those are the three things that reveals a person. You must have a will, intellect, and emotions. And when the Bible says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit, it simply means, don't make him sad. Let me explain that verse shortly. That verse simply means, do not give the Holy Spirit a funeral atmosphere. Okay, what does it mean? Don't grieve him. Don't make him sad. What makes him sad? And then it mentions all the things, the verses before and the verses after. Bitterness makes him sad. Corrupt communication makes him sad. In other words, what makes the Holy Spirit sad is, after he has seen the work of redemption, that there should be a change of a lifestyle and you producing the fruit of the Spirit in your life, love and all of those things. When there's so much life in you of the Son, but you still live as if you are dead, you are grieving the Holy Spirit. So that's what that verse means. When we address those things that have to do with sins against the Holy Spirit, don't quench the Holy Spirit. You could be sitting here and the Holy Spirit is busy speaking to you, saying, give something to someone. Or he's saying, share this word with someone. Or hand over your jacket. Or give your shoes. But you quench the Holy Spirit. He's busy telling you something. There's a relationship, and in that relationship, he's speaking to you. And as he speaks to you, you put it off, like you're putting fire off. You can see that there's no pastor who gave you the instruction, but there's an inward voice and an inward peace that propels and prompts you to do something. When you put it off, you are sinning against the Holy Spirit. You are quenching him. Hence, that verse is associated with other verses that say, do not quench the Spirit and do not despise prophesying. Because every time you're going to, you have to go and prophesy, you are not actually sure about what you're going to say. That is why fear can destroy you while you are still going to that person. Because those are not your ways and those are not your facts, so you are not sure. You see, when a person gets to a place where they are sure, they are talking about what they know. But it is the Holy Spirit that actually knows the secret things, what the person, and I'm not talking about the prophetic that is pathetic. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the kind of prophetic or you need to beg a prophet for a prophetic word. I'm talking about the kind of prophetic that is edifying. Open domain or edification. I'm talking about prophecy that brings edification, comfort, and exhortation. The kind of prophecy where when you speak, you are not only speaking a wave of knowledge that reveals a particular situation in the past, but you are addressing something destiny-related. That actually catches the person for a lifetime. Have you ever met that prophet that spoke to you once and it's like enough? Even to this day, you are sustained by that very prophetic word. Not the one that needs to, you know, say something all the time. Get into my system, Papa. Tell me this and this. And all those things that Christians are doing today out of desperation. And the prophetic has become pathetic because people are using it to make money. And they are merchandising the Holy Ghost. Remember the sin of Simon, the sorcerer. Can I buy the Holy Ghost? And Peter rebuked him, says, you are a wicked heart. It is wickedness to think that you can make money through the Holy Ghost. Amen. While you are clapping, when you go to a prophet, you go with a gift, what you gather in the Old Testament, isn't it? But the prophet was not the one that said they must bring the gift. They decided. That is the difference. The minute somebody puts a price on the anointing, that anointing is already fake. The motives are wrong. The false prophet is false. It's false. What makes you false is not your accuracy, remember? No. What makes you false is not your accuracy. You can be accurate through the spirit of divination. You can flow in a familiar spirit and be accurate about whose grandma, what phone number, and still be not the Holy Ghost. So, listen to me. Even if I release facts about your life, you must discern the source. Anyone that prophesies, you must also remember you have the Holy Ghost also. So as you prophesy, there must be a leaping of the baby in me, as much as there's a release of the prophet before you. So the Holy Spirit protects me from all the false prophets. So I'm saying to you, don't be afraid of a false prophet or a true one. Just judge what they say by the words. Allow the guy to say the best accurate word. And the prophetic is not about accuracy, it's about intimacy. If you are just close to the king, so that after performing this thing, he can at least say, I know you. Amen. So, the Holy Spirit is a person. He has a will, he has emotions. There's some things that you do, and it feels sad because at that time he's expecting you to act in a particular way, only to find out you're not acting according to your new creation nature. And he's sad. He knows you can do better than that, particularly for this grace generation. And by the way, it is important for you to understand mercy before you preach grace. Because mercy paid the price for you not to get what you deserve. So that grace can announce what you don't deserve. So there are people that are preaching greasy grace, and they are picking it from books without verification, scriptural. Some people are just caught up in a hype. Others just want to follow what is trending. But I can tell you, if there's anything that's trending forever, it's the will of God. It doesn't change.
Amen.
Your character will change, and other things will change, but His word never changes. Amen. Now, my last 5 minutes of connecting you with the Holy Spirit. The spirit of man, Proverbs, is a candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. Proverbs 20:27. Proverbs 20:12. The hearing ear and the seeing eye, both of them are made by God. When God gives you a gift of the Holy Spirit, that gift is presented to you in its most perfect state. No flaws. The only problem about it is your inability to use it. So there's room for you to experiment with it, not to play with it. Because it is not a toy, it is a tool to help generations. So the Holy Spirit imparts this gift. Gifts are given. And in the gifts that are given, God makes you to operate in that particular gift. Now, when God makes someone a prophet, if he gives you the gift of prophecy, you can stay up. It is yours 24/7. You can wait for the Spirit coming upon you to move you into prophetic dimensions. Or you can, like Timothy, stir up the gift because it is within you 24/7. So you can either depend on the anointing upon, which is external, or the anointing within, which is internal. So you can either prophesy from drawing from the eternal, because there are three rivers flowing in you. There's a river from the throne, Revelation 22, verse 1, it makes you a king. There's a river from the temple, Ezekiel 47, verse 1, it makes you a priest. There's a river from the belly, John chapter 7, it makes you a prophet. That is why when we talk about speaking in tongues, there are three levels of tongues. Acts chapter 2, verse 4, we call that the category of other tongues. What is that? For evangelistic purposes. These are other people languages. The same word is used in the Greek xenoglossolalia, which includes all inclusive of edification, those tongues that are devotional. But to be more specific with the text contextually is to address that there were 16 languages that gathered at Pentecost. They were speaking other people's languages. It was not just rabba-la-la-la, where you don't hear yourself, they don't hear you. It was other people's languages. In other words, the course of people in the Saviors were speaking Afrikaans. And Afrikaans people in the Saviors were speaking Tswana. The Tswana people in the Saviors were speaking Sout. So the people could identify that this is a move of God. Why? Because the barbarian that divided the languages met the Pentecost that united the languages. Mm. So at Pentecost, the languages were divided. At Babel, the languages were divided. At Pentecost, the languages were united. Amen. Now, it's other people's languages. Where is the confusion in the church? When we go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 2, it is now called the unknown tongues. It says, when you speak them, you don't hear yourself. Mm. Where those people who hear you, they don't hear you. How be it in the spirit, you are speaking mysteries. What is their purpose? Devotional purposes. Those ones, when we are in a setup like this, and we all start going karabashandalabahanda, all of us, and we start getting into it. When we lift up the volume, you have the right to lift up the volume as well. But when we lower our volume as well, you also bring down your volume, because we are all on edification purposes. Mm. Because if you remain alone, you are suggesting that you've got interpretation. Mm. You are suggesting that you say that the Lord can speak to the saints. And be careful about being in an atmosphere of worship. And when you are in that atmosphere of worship and the wind blows, right? The right illustration will be, if the wind blows against the trees, some of the trees they whistle, some of the trees they clap, some of the trees they bend. Yeah? So when we are in the presence of the Lord, we don't act the same. Yeah. So don't judge the guy who's not bowing. He's just reacting differently from the moving of the wind. As the wind blows, the other one will shout. The other one will feel like I can lay prostrate or sit down. All of that will respond differently. So don't judge other people by thinking because they are not responding according to expectation, they are not in the spirit. Mm. So also be careful about yielding to the spirit as if you are with him alone in a room. Mm. When you are in a public service, I'm warning you, and I'm saving you from people who are not going to have mercy on you.
Yeah.
When we start the service and we are all worshiping the Lord and we are all in the spirit and all of that, and then when Chichi get 1, 2, 3, 6, and then we are all like Jesus, we are but changed down, and you are still there, my brother and my sister, and already you are already vibrating, and you are doing all kinds of things. The whole service attention is on you. The challenge with that is that you must understand that the spirit of a prophet is a subject to the prophet. We all understand the sovereign move of God. If God can come in while I'm still speaking, as a priest I can't minister. Because the doxa, the kabat, the weight of the glory of the Lord will put me off ministry, because the main minister is in the house, then I don't have to do ministry. I have to just step aside. So when there's a sovereign move of God, some of you will feel, I want to go under a chair. Nobody would have told you anything. Other people will just go to the wall, and you will never know what people want to do. Others will start screaming, others will start crying. There's a sovereign move of God. But if it is not sovereign, the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. So if we are no longer screaming, my sister, reduce your screams. If we are no longer vibrating, because chances are, if I'm a deliverance minister and I understand the order of the saints according to public order, all things must be done decently and in order, and I find you utataze, chances are, if my discernment tells me it's a demon, I don't want to be the demon that night. If my discernment tells me it's the Holy Ghost, I might as well say, hallelujah, the Holy Spirit is here. But don't put yourself in a spot and make yourself a target, because you might be embarrassed when you came to the Savior and you yielded yourself beyond it.
Amen.
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 Last verse. Okay, the other level of tongues is gifts of tongues. Only people who have the gift of diverse kinds of tongues can operate in these three levels. It is compulsory. Devotional level of tongues is compulsory. Other tongues, evangelistic purposes, diverse kinds of tongues, few people are gifted by the Holy Ghost with such. When I pray in the Spirit, my understanding is unfruitful. Paul says, my understanding is unfruitful. So when I go, Rabba, Shanda, Rigo, Dende, Reba, Konda, I'm done. Reba, Shoteri, Adve. Everybody is like, Rabba, Shanda. Your minds are going, we wonder what's going to happen next. Rabba, Shanda, Rabba, Kanda. And then another person feels, okay, let me join Muruti, you know, let me make this video. I'm going to be awful. I can make a song. Try to pray in tongues at 11 o'clock, and you have an appointment at half past. verse 11. Rabba Shada. Appointment. Because every time you pray in tongues, the Holy Spirit orders your day first. He orders your day. He reminds you of your responsibilities. He speaks to you in the area. So he's not some spooky Holy Ghost. He's a person. You understand that? So when I pray in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit wants to deal with the part of the things that have to do with my anxieties, things I'm concerned about, where am I going to get the money, why are people treating me this way, and all of those things that are going through your mind. So you go like, and guess what? How do you then release the word of the Lord, and how do you then prophesy? Remember, we read the letter says, I have the mind of Christ. So listen, not all the thoughts that go through your mind every day are your thoughts. There's thoughts from the enemy that are going to go through your mind. There's thoughts from God that are going to go through your mind. But unfortunately, they sound, they feel like your thoughts. The problem is that when people want to hear from God, they are waiting for an angelic visitation. And they think that's maturity. Can I tell you something? Cornelius met an angel, but he was still a baby in the Lord. So meeting angels is not a sign of maturity. It's probably at some time a sign that you are so weak in faith, God has to drop you to God has to be so dramatic just for him to show you something that will make you believe. And you come to church and say, Pastor Juan, don't worry, I want to call and then body to lose. And now I'm going to be intimidated by your encounters. Now listen to me. When I pray in the Spirit, as I close. When I pray in the Spirit, when I pray in the Spirit, and I'm praying for my sister, then I pray in the Spirit, my thought, my mind becomes unfruitful because it gets to be irritated by the words. Because your mind is going to be, say something that makes sense. And then your mind goes like, yeah, and it shuts down and it becomes what? Unfruitful. And when that happens, spontaneous thoughts from your spirit can now go into your mind. Now the problem will be you will doubt it is God because it still sounds like your mind. The only thing that you now have to discern whether is this God or not. Have you ever drive and then you start playing music and you create an atmosphere? And then the Lord said, you start praying, Jim. Your direction was maybe going to watch a movie with a friend or whatever it is. And then you start thinking about one of the brothers in the fellowship. And whatever that you were doing is not connected with where you were going. Spontaneous thoughts from the Holy Spirit are those thoughts that interject your thought process. They seem to register and they can be easily driven away if you don't put attention to them. If you ignore them, they don't come back. They just move away. And that's how the Holy Spirit speaks. At the time when you are expecting a big voice from the roof, the Holy Spirit says, I'm just lifting up thoughts from the Holy Spirit in you to communicate to you. So these are thoughts that becomes the voice. So it's not audible voice. It's spontaneous thoughts. And those spontaneous thoughts become the voice of the Holy Spirit whenever they are recognized as the Holy Spirit. So you will never, under any circumstance, tell me you don't hear from God. You've been hearing from God. It's just that you've not been recognized. Mm. Your problem is recognition. And your life will start changing the day you start being sensitive to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And that sensitivity begins in fellowship. And that fellowship is developed through the speaking in tongues. As I speak in tongues, my understanding is unfruitful. And I start receiving thoughts from the throne that were not there before I spoke in tongues. It's like when I speak in tongues, they become more clear. They become more loud. The Holy Spirit is gentle. So if he releases those thought patterns, if you ignore, he's not going to insist. So you have all been hearing from God. How? My sheep hear my voice, not unless you are a goat. If you are a sheep, you should be hearing. Nobody will teach you. We only help you to recognize what you are hearing. So the ultimate What is the ultimate about fellowshipping with the Holy Spirit? One.